It was with those opening notes that I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt as a kid that I was going to fall completely in love with the world of The Legend of Zelda. There was times I'd leave the title screen on just to listen to this song, because as far as video game music went, nothing at that time that I had experienced was this epic. It's resonated with me so much that to this day, I play the song like I've modernized it on guitar and made like a quote-unquote rock version of it and metal version or whatever you want to call it. Because this music just set the tone for what was about to happen. And to see all the stuff that was going to be in this game scrolling through your screen, it's like, I'm going to have to find all this. And there was just something about that sense of awe and amazement that you kind of knew it was going to be epic, but you weren't sure what you were getting into until you started the game. And the epicness only continued. You started on this bare screen, didn't really know what to do. You went into the little cave. You go by, at the time, I didn't realize it was a wooden sword, but apparently that's what it's supposed to be. I just thought it was a brown sword. But you had no direction. Nothing telling you where to go, what you had to do. You were just supposed to find it and figure things out on your own, or talk to your friends, or, you know, keep in mind, 1986, I think this came to the States in 87. You didn't have the internet. So there was no way to get online and look up a walkthrough and try to figure out what you were supposed to do, you know? You just had to experiment and run out of bombs and use your candle and burn trees, and it was great. You know, there was minimal story. All you knew was some evil wizard named Ganon had kidnapped Princess Zelda, and she split the Triforce up, and you had to go find it and go save her, you know? And that was your meat and potatoes to the story. And walking around, you know, you go to a couple areas, but you couldn't grasp how truly huge the world map was. I mean, look at that. That was the overworld that you could traverse with very minimal gear requirements. I mean, some areas would have been harder than others, depending on whether or not you had the magical shield or what sword you had. But outside of the couple dungeons you needed certain items to get to, you could go anywhere in the overworld right off the bat. And that kind of exploration at the time was something that was unheard of, and it just sucked you in. And this was a game I spent, oh my god, I couldn't even tell you how much time I put into the original Legend of Zelda, trying to find every secret and every nook and cranny and unexplored cave, and I must have spent hundreds and hundreds of thousands of rupees on bombs to blow up walls to see if there would be a hidden opening there. And you got to keep in mind, we're talking about a game that when it was in its testing phases, originally when the game was first tested, you started with the sword and the shield, and people were bitching that they didn't know what to do and that it was too hard because they didn't know where to go. So Miyamoto, his solution to the whole problem was, let's take your shield away, or let's take your sword away and give it to this old guy in the cave in the first screen that you start on. And it worked. People did a little bit more thinking for themselves and trying to figure things out on their own. And I mean, I'm sure I wasn't the only one. There was people out there that had notebooks full of secrets and bomb this rock on the, or go three screens to the right, bomb the rock in the top corner, four steps in, or something. You know, I mean, that's just pulling that out of my ass, but that's the kind of things that you did for a game like this at that time. You know, we didn't have the wikis and strategy guides. Well, we had strategy guides, but not right away. You didn't have internet walkthroughs, you didn't have game facts or anything like that where you could go and find these detailed walkthroughs written by the community or websites that did walkthroughs, no YouTube, you know. and this was the kind of stuff you were finding. Okay, how do I master using it? And what waterfall? There's a couple waterfalls. Which waterfall should I walk into? And what old woman? Where's this old woman at? There's a lot of old women I've come across. I mean, it was just that a whole, you had to figure everything out on your own. And at first, it seemed intimidating, but it was awesome. You could go into a dungeon, you could get the item you wanted that was in the dungeon and skedaddle, and you could, within limitations, you could do the dungeons in basically any order, because unlike subsequent Zelda games, you didn't need the item in the previous dungeon to get through the second dungeon, or however it would work out. Very. The 3D Zelda games, as much as I like them, are very linear in nature and structure. They are fantastic games, but they do not have the open world exploration that you had in this original Zelda game. Even Zelda 2 didn't have a lot of flexibility in how you completed dungeons. To a lesser extent, A Link to the Past was the same way. It was a little bit more open than Zelda 2, but it was a little bit more linear than the original game was. And I think that with the announcement of The Legend of Zelda for the Wii U, I think they understood they had reached a little bit of a problem with having that linearity in the game, because that was one of the first things that was brought up, was that they wanted you to be able to go anywhere on the world map. They didn't want certain areas locked off because you didn't have a certain weapon or an item. And I think for a lot of us that grew up playing this original game, there's probably going to be, hopefully, there's going to be some nostalgia feelings there, because hopefully that's, you get that same grand scope and sense of wonder and adventure that you got playing this game. And as I said, that there's nothing wrong with the other Zelda games, and in fact, the original game isn't even my favorite out of the series. My favorite kind of flip-flops between A Link to the Past and Twilight Princess, but nothing has had that same hugeness that this game originally had. While Ocarina of Time and Twilight Princess are epic in their own rights, they're not these huge, enormous, figure everything out on your own type of games that this game was. You had Navi telling you what to do, Midna to a lesser extent than Navi. So far in Skyward Sword, Fi, whatever, tells you what you have to do probably 20 minutes before you end up having to do it. I mean, it's ridiculous in Skyward Sword. So I'm anxious to see how that's going to pan out in the new game with not having that guide or that character telling you what to do or where to go, and kind of relying more on, I went here and blew up this rock and found this dungeon, and or I went here and let's say there's an instrument in the game. I'm sure there will be. There's always an instrument in a Zelda game. Play the ocarina or the harp or whatever it happens to get, and this tree opens up and there's Dungeon 7 or something. I mean, it's just, that's what I'm really hoping to recapture, that same feeling that you got playing this first game, because it got so much right its first time through that I think that's what brought a lot of the. That's why some people. The sequel is very divisive. There's some people I've seen that think it's perfectly fine, it fits in with the Zelda series. There's others that hate it because of it's so different from what came before it and after it, which arguably, there's nothing wrong with it being different from what came after, because, I mean, at least they tried something new. Kind of had that they kind of went with that side-scrolling Castlevania type of adventure style game. But to me, it was still a Zelda game. But this game, I think since it touched on all the right bases, that... unless they made a carbon copy of it for the second game, you weren't going to please everybody. But this game, everything worked, at least from my viewpoint, everything worked. You had this grand sense of adventure, which was reinforced wonderfully by the music. Koji Kondo, for what they could do with the sound chip in the NES, composed a score that just stuck with you. I mean, even to this day, I'll be at work sometimes and I'll start whistling this, or actually most of the Zelda music, because the one thing about the franchise as a whole, the music has always been very, very well done and fitting with the theme of the game. But this, the music in this first one, I mean, there was only four songs. You had your title track, which, like I said, that just those opening notes and that dun-dun-dun-dun, I mean, that just, it was like, it just kicked you in your ass and commanded your attention. Then you had the overworld theme, which was a little bit more lighthearted. It didn't have that bass drone and the drums that the intro had. The dungeon themes were pretty intimidating sounding, you know, to the ears of a 8-year-old or a 6-year-old. Yeah, I would have been 6 in 88. Wow. God, I'm getting old. But, and then the Death Mountain dungeon, the final dungeon, when you go in Ganon's dungeon, the music in there is just scary. Like, you're playing it, it's like, what am I going to encounter in here? And just to remind people of how different things were back then, this is the dungeon for... this is Ganon's Death Mountain dungeon right here. This is Death Mountain in the original Legend of Zelda game. And there's two ways you could get through this dungeon depending on whether or not you had the magical key. Of course, you needed the Triforce fully assembled first and foremost, but that's, yeah, and every enemy in the game that you absolutely dreaded encountering was in this dungeon. You had the Wizrobes, you had Like-Likes, which were little bastards that ate your magical shield. You had, I think there was Dark Nuts, the Centaur guys, whatever they called, the Lionels. You had Patras, you had, I think just about every dungeon boss you came across in the game was packed into this dungeon too. I can't remember if there was a Gleok or not, but I'm pretty sure there was an Aquamantis and a Manhandla. Maybe. I don't know. But I mean, it was tough. And to make it through here, you needed both endurance, because if you didn't know where you were going, you were going to spend a lot of time backtracking. And you needed quick wits to defeat the enemies that were in each room. And you needed a lot of patience, especially when you got to Ganon, because when you walked in, you couldn't see him. This is what you encountered when you made it into the final room where Ganon was. And you're getting these fireballs thrown at you and you can't see them. You're like, what do I do? You know, so I mean, you just kind of have to stab your sword around wildly and hope you hit him. And then he'll reveal himself and you can pop him with the silver arrows. And then if you didn't have the silver arrow, you were really screwed, because you could make it all the way into his room without it. And I mean, I don't know how many people had the unfortunate luck of making it all the way to Ganon without a silver arrow or whatever, but if you did, I mean, it was, I'm sure it was probably rage-inducing trying to figure out what you were supposed to do until you talked to somebody or an issue of Nintendo Power. I can't remember if Nintendo Power ever documented exactly how to go through the game. I know there was a strategy guide, because, oh man, I remember having it. It was a Nintendo... it was just for the NES. It had the first three Castlevania games, I think both Zelda games, the first three Mario games, a couple others, I forget what the other games were. It had a bunch of Nintendo games, and it was a thick-ass strategy guide. It was awesome, though. I think it was part of a package for renewing your subscription, but it had, I mean, there was stuff in there. It was like, oh, that's where you find that heart container or something, you know? Man, I wish I think I still, I might have it somewhere, I can't remember, but, I mean, it explained in detail how to defeat Ganon and everything. I had beaten the game by then, through trial and error, and talking to, like, my neighbors and stuff like that, and other kids that played the game at school and things, but, you know, that was, that really brought people together that played the game, because, I mean, you had to talk to people and bounce ideas back and forth to try to figure out what was going on, and it was brilliant. Also, I wish they would find some way to modernize this sword beam sound and put that in a modern Zelda title, because that sound is so fucking iconic. I mean, they used it in the cartoon. Whenever Link shot a beam in the cartoon, there's just something about that noise. I don't know if because you heard it so many times playing the game, and as much time as people spent playing the game, that sound just got burned in your brain, kind of like Mario's original brick-breaking sound, or the coin, or his jumping sound. You know, some of those Nintendo sounds, I mean, just stuck with you. They were, for, like I said, for the sound chip that was in the NES, there was some really good both music and sound effects for, I think they could only use like 4 sine waves or something like that when they composed their music and had their sounds in there. But it just complemented the foundation that was there with the exploration and the adventuring that was the groundwork for the game. And, oh man, I remember, like, my dad, he'd go up north to go hunting, and he had buddies up there that he'd go up there with. I'd go up with him, and I'd take my NES, and I'd be playing Zelda or my Legos. I remember using my Legos. I'd had the knights and stuff like that, and deck one out and all green and give him a sword and a shield, and that was Link, and I'd build little castles and dungeons and stuff like that for him to go through, and little Lego Gleox and stuff like that. And I mean, this was a game. Super Mario Brothers, when I got my NES, is what got me into gaming. But The Legend of Zelda is what got me. It's the first game that really pulled me in, grabbed a hold of me, and didn't let go. To me, this is one of the few franchises that is a system seller. I bought a Wii U based on the pure simple fact that eventually someday there will be a Zelda game for it. So far, just Hyrule Warriors and The Wind Waker, which I am enjoying, because I didn't play Wind Waker on the GameCube. But this game, I've probably replayed more than any other game that I've owned. I have completed The Legend of Zelda 25 times. And I think the only game I might have completed more than that is the Mass Effect trilogy. Or not more than that. The second most I've completed a game would have been the Mass Effect trilogy. I've played through the Mass Effect trilogy 12 times, I think. But, you know, and growing up, I was one of those kids that I was into things like the medieval fantasy and horror and things like that, you know. So, The Legend of Zelda really tapped into that love for, like, the knights and the dragons and the whole, like I said, the medieval fantasy stuff and adventuring and things of that nature. For the horror stuff, obviously, I had Castlevania, which that's a topic for another video. But this game just enamored me so much at such a young age, and I think probably that's why it had such a lasting impact on me, was because I was so young when I played it. And playing it now, I still get that same sense of awe and wonder that I had when I was six, you know? And, I mean, I'm 32 now. And even playing the sequels, you know, playing Ocarina of Time and Twilight Princess, and all those games always managed to make you, or make me, they bring both wonderment and amazement, and they also remind me of a time that I look back on fondly. You know, I mean, a more innocent, impressionable time where you're amazed a lot more easier than you are now, but it was a good time, you know, and to be able to have a franchise stick with you for that long is both a testament to the quality of the franchise and the strength and impact that that initial entry into the franchise made. And I'm sure everybody has something that has stuck with them through the years, and whether it be something new or old, you know. But, like, to me, this is, I get the same sense of fanboyism, I guess you could say, or obsession with The Legend of Zelda that, like, Star Wars people have with the original three movies, you know. That's just how big this became for me. And when we moved to a little bit more of a country setting, you know, there was woods and trees and stuff like that, and I'd find sticks and shit and tape guards on them and make swords out of them and things like that, and be running through the woods pretending I was Link. And man, I was a fucking dork when I was a kid. And I think what really made this work so well was you had this blank slate character that you were Link, you know, that was their intention. That's why they named him Link. He was supposed to be the link between the player and the game, and it worked. And the only modern game outside of the franchise that gave me the same sense of adventure, wonder, and sense of satisfaction when I figured something out or discovered a new hidden place or something like that, or got an item, would be, and I'm probably going to get some flack for this, but I would say Skyrim. In fact, my wife at the time, when I first started playing Skyrim, you know, she was like, well, what's this? I was like, it's The Legend of Zelda for adults, essentially, is what I considered Skyrim to be. And I probably can't correctly express the excitement that I have for The Legend of Zelda Wii U. And I know people, that if you stumble across this video, I'm probably going to sound very fanboyish. I'm not a fanboy to a particular console. I am franchise fanboy. I can fanboy pretty hard over certain franchises. But the fact that that game could possibly be tapping into that same creative vein and feeling that this original game did, that immediately grabbed and commanded my attention. And if it delivers on the expectations that I'm sure myself and I'm sure other people have for that, and if it can turn this game that came out in 1987, if it can take that foundation and turn that into a successful formula in a modern game, you could quite very well be looking at the game of the year for 2015 when it comes out. Because you'll have the strength of the franchise name, and if they put out a really amazing title with new mechanics and formulas that haven't been in a Zelda game since the 80s, then it could quite well be a home run, and I hope it is. But we're going to wrap this up. I've been rambling on for a while now. And, you know, like always, guys, I want to thank you all for watching, and we'll see you in the next one. Also, I can't believe I made it through this whole video without mentioning the gold cartridge. Tell me that wasn't fucking awesome.